Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to episode 13 of Hawk Talk. I'm your host, Bryce Johnson. This week, I am joined by the commissioner of the Commonwealth Coast Conference, Gregg Kaye. Gregg, how are you today?
Doing great, Bryce. Thanks so much for having me. Looking forward to our conversation today.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for being willing to come on and making the time this week, and we'll jump right into it. And over the summer, the CCC was forced into canceling the fall season. You have since postponed the decision on the status of the winter season as well. But tell us about the decision-making process at the conference level in regards to its handling of the whole COVID-19 situation.
Absolutely. Since March, when everything really took a turn for the worse, we've just been involved in meeting after meeting, emails like crazy, group texts, things like that. Our presidents have pretty much met monthly at some points in times, maybe a little more frequently than that. Is they're the group that ultimately makes the decisions as far as the path that the conference is going to take. Also during that time, our athletic directors have been meeting at least once a week. So, you know, it really is a lot of sharing of information, what's going on each individual campus, what's happening throughout New England, what's happening throughout Division III. What makes it really tricky on the conference level is that you've got institutions in three different states. I would even consider the city of Boston to almost be its own entity, so to speak. So you've got a lot of things going on in a lot of different places. So it's constantly trying to learn what's going on in our industry, what's going on in other parts of the world. And, you know, you reach a point where you may not necessarily have the direction that you're looking for from the NCAA. And that's okay, because what may be right for one may not be right for another league, especially when you start looking at different parts of the country. So a lot of keeping each other updated on what's happening on individual campuses. We took a little bit of a break the week of Thanksgiving, but then this week we're right back into things. So we continue the conversations. Our presidents right now are targeting, you know, a mid to late January conversation for the next discussion that they have. And really that's intended to, you know, make sure we're dealing with and making decisions on the most current situation for all of our campuses, you know, where we are in our part of the country. So it continues to be ongoing. You know, at some point we're going to be able to get back to doing the things that we love to do. We're going to get back to doing all the things that we miss. But until we get to that point, it, you know, the conversation continues. And hopefully when, you know, vaccines start to roll out and whatnot, maybe things start taking a turn for the better, we'll keep our fingers crossed. You know, like everybody else, we're anxious to get back to play, but we want to be able to do it at a time that is safe for everybody to be doing so.
Absolutely. As much as I want to have Hawk Sports back to cover, you got to consider the safety of everyone first. And COVID-19 has presented numerous problems for a number of organizations, including the CCC and its member schools. These problems go beyond just canceling seasons. Tell us about the difficulties 2020 has presented at the conference level, and what are you doing to try to adjust to the new normal?
Yeah, that really is a good question, and probably something that flies under the radar screen a little bit. And, you know, the question that we get even in normal times from a lot of folks is, what exactly do you do in the conference office? And certainly there are some parts of our operation that are going to be a lot more visible. You know, in normal times, we're conducting championships and handing out trophies and that sort of thing. And, you know, obviously we're not able to do that. You know, what really is a big challenge, you know, besides navigating really what would be uncharted waters, you know, we're dealing with subject material that in a lot of ways is really foreign to us. You know, we all wear a lot of hats in athletics, but we're not medical doctors. We're not infectious disease experts and things like that. So, you know, the new normal, I think, really involves a lot of learning about what we're dealing with, you know, an evaluation of what others might be doing to see if those are things that, you know, perhaps we would like to tackle. But when we talk about the learning, part of our new normal for now is that we focused a great deal on student athlete development. And that's really what all of our institutions are also doing. But they have the opportunity to do that really in what I guess you would call normal times, because developing student athletes, developing people, that's really the essence of Division III athletics. It's part of the overall program. People develop their talents, discover things that are of interest to them, you know, and dedicate themselves to making things better, not just for themselves and their teams, but for their communities as well. So, you know, we focused largely on programming. We've been able to dust off some old ideas that maybe we talked about at some point in time, but we really never had the opportunity to do them. And my hope is some of the things that we've been doing in terms of programming, in terms of some new awards that we've come up with that aren't necessarily related to competition, hopefully those are going to be things that we can continue to do into the future. So we're evaluating where we are in terms of competition, but we're also laying the groundwork for the future. And I think we've rolled out really some amazing programs. We've got some others that are in the works so that, you know, after the holiday season, we can bring some fresh things to what we're doing and continue using programming to make the conference really special for our student athletes.
And one of those programming ideas is the CCC Person of the Week. Tell us about that.
Absolutely. You know, we've talked at length for many years about the fact that, you know, while we focus on teams that win championships, individuals who are maybe excelling and, you know, win all conference honors, athlete of the week honors, things of that nature, there really are so many people that are out there who are just doing some really amazing things, not just amazing things for college students, but amazing things as people in general. So we came up with an idea where we would try to recognize some of those folks. And we've been able to recognize people who have been involved in diversity issues on their campus, people who are helping out with research. We've recognized, you know, our interns who have been folks who have helped put those stories together, others who are creating athletic leagues of their own to kind of fill the void. And it really has been fascinating just learning and talking about some of the people who are out there. A lot of these folks may not really get recognized for their contributions to their teams. They may have a specific role that they're playing, so we never really focus on, you know, their statistics or their achievements, but they're doing great things. And we just want the world to be able to know what wonderful things young people can look forward to if they identify a CCC institution as a place where they'd like to go to for their college experience. And with all these little pieces that we've been doing where there's stories and there's videos, maybe somebody will click on one of them and say, you know what, that's me. What a young lady at Roger Williams is doing, that's exactly what I want to be doing a few years down the road. So in a lot of ways, it's, you know, making sure that folks know that Division III student athletes are not just about their sports. Our athletic departments and our athletic teams, you know, while they want to compete and they want to win and they play at the highest level, they're also about developing people. So we've just been able to tell a lot of really, really great stories that if it had been business as usual, maybe we wouldn't have had the opportunity to do that. So it's really been a lot of fun working on those pieces, you know, seeing what our interns, including a young man from Roger Williams, Sebastian Suarez, who's a lacrosse player, he's been a part of putting those packages together. And it's really great seeing them excel in their creativity and also how they go about telling some of these stories. So it really has been a lot of fun and hopefully something that we're going to continue to do into the future, not just telling student athlete stories, but maybe we get to focus on some coaches and administrators who are doing some really neat things in their role and in their life. So it's been a lot of fun. We've made the rounds through the conference once. Now we'll start up again and we'll see where it takes us.
That's awesome. And yeah, we were kind of talking a little bit before we came on the airs. You know, the purpose of this podcast is to show the person behind the student athlete. And I think this is another way that the conference is doing a very similar thing. Now, back in 2007, you were appointed as the first full-time commissioner for the Commonwealth Coast Conference. What did that mean to you? And what have you tried to bring to the conference across your 14-year tenure at the helm?
That's a great question. And it's really hard to believe that it's been, you know, 14 years since an amazing opportunity came my way. Personally, it allowed my wife and I to return to the Northeast and, more importantly, grow our family. We have three children, you know, of different ages who have all been adopted. And had we not relocated to the Northeast, we may not have had the opportunity to adopt those kids. And it's been absolutely a lot of fun and very rewarding for us. Both of us grew up in the Northeast, so it's really exciting to be back in that part of the country. Professionally, the opportunity allowed me to guide the ship as opposed to being strictly the worker bee. The CCC staff, you know, and I use that term in quotes, back before I was hired as the first full-time commissioner, you know, they tended to be part-time people, in many cases, athletic department staff from around the league would fill in serving as, you know, perhaps the commissioner or the assistant commissioner, you know, the conference sports information people, that sort of thing. So it really allowed the conference to have more of a dedicated structure in place, primarily through staffing that was only focused on conference. And really over the years, and especially as that second position has grown from a part-time weekly position into a full-time associate commissioner position, we've really tried to increase visibility and involvement of the conference staff, as that really, you know, leads to a better experience for student athletes, coaches, and et cetera. I guess the way I like to, you know, think about it is when I turn the clock back to 2007 and before then, you know, at that point you had a lot of part-time coaches in the league. And, you know, I talked about, you know, people filling the role at the conference office. So maybe the resources weren't quite what they are now. And in a lot of ways, it almost had more of a mom and pop feel to it. You know, coaches in one sport would be doing what they would want to do. And if there was a coach who, you know, maybe had been in that role for 20 years and everybody else was kind of a revolving door, you know, you might have one person that was really kind of guiding the ship for their group. So it's really been nice to be able to put some sort of a structure that's in place, refine it over the years, make sure that it's serving the members and the institutions that comprise the conference. So I think we've come a long way. That stage, it was fairly uncommon for a Division III conference to have a full-time commissioner or a full-time staff for that matter. And, you know, now a decade and a half later, you know, we have a lot of conferences out there that, you know, may even have three or four full-time people to spread the work around. So it's amazing how it's changed. It's amazing how it's evolved, but just the way that we do things right now and the changes that we constantly strive to make, it's always been all about creating the best experience that we can for our student athletes. And I think, you know, while we accomplished that back in 2007, we're accomplishing it in so many more ways now that we probably didn't even envision way back then.
And you have guided the conference as it has grown, not only in the number of sports that it has and the number of schools it has, but just is grown in general. Tell us about some of those growths and what do you look forward to potentially expanding the CCC brand moving forward?
Yeah, I think when our presidents meet and our athletic directors meet, we're always trying to, you know, explore what some of the next things might be down the road. What are things that maybe our institutions are starting to do, maybe things that, you know, ways that they're starting to grow where the next step is that the conference grows. You know, during the time that I've been here, we've added several new sports, and I'll use men's golf as an example. When we're first looking at, you know, getting an automatic bid, we needed to be at 7 schools in order to get that automatic bid from Division III. And if you don't have schools that are participating in a sport, there's really not a whole lot that you can do about it. So that's an example where, you know, when the conversation started taking shape and we wound up getting a little bit closer to that magic number of 7, you have a school like Roger Williams that says, you know what, we're going to go ahead and do that. That's going to enhance what we're doing as an athletic department. That's going to enhance our university community. It's going to help the conference out. And the same thing happened when Roger Williams added field hockey. We had an automatic bid, but you hate being right on the cusp of not having enough schools to be able to do that. So, you know, that's a case where the collaboration and the conversation leads to institutions making decisions that not only are the best for the school, but the best for the conference as well. We've seen it, you know, not just in men's golf, but we've been able to do it in women's track and field, where, you know, some schools felt the timing was right to add some programs. Certainly football and men's ice hockey, which Roger Williams is not a part of, but those were also important steps where institutions, instead of having to look outside their multi-sport conference, now have everything right here in front of them. And we'll be adding women's ice hockey. We're at the point now where that's going to be starting up, hopefully, in a couple months once the calendar kicks over. And it really sends a good message, because if you have somebody who's competing in that student in that sport, but their roommate who's a student athlete may be competing in another sport, when they're in different conferences, the experience can be a little bit different. So it really, it ensures that every student athlete at our member schools is in a position where they're going to be able to have the same quality experience across the board. And I think in time, you know, we may start seeing some sports like men's volleyball, where the numbers are starting to continually grow. That may be something that comes up down the pike. A lot of our schools have been fielding either varsity or club rugby programs. Rugby is now an emerging sport in the NCAA on the women's side. So I think it would be just a great thing if we would be able to, you know, reach a point where those teams who are playing at the club level, if their institutions say, you know what, we're going to turn this into a varsity sport. If we've got enough of them, maybe we have the opportunity to be one of the first Division III conferences that would sponsor a conference rugby championship. So there's a lot of examples that are out there, you know, as far as the membership goes. When we started adding some sports, it opened the doors for us to be able to bring in some associate members in a couple of the sports where we were really close to having 7, but we weren't there yet. And throughout that process, it also allowed us to ask the question, you know, do we want to expand? And this year we've added Suffolk University to the mix. And that's a case where you're not just adding somebody, but you're adding the right institution that does things in a similar fashion to everybody else. Their membership enhances the conference. Our conference hopefully helps them to elevate what they're doing. So between sports sponsorship and membership, those are really ongoing conversations that we're always having at the AD and the president's levels, just to see what might come next. And you know, sometimes it's slow going. Sometimes things happen quickly. But those are really fun conversations to have, because at the end of the day, you know, if you're able to, you know, add sport or add institutions, what you're essentially doing is enhancing the experience, which I've talked about several times. And that's really what it's all about.
It's really exciting to hear about the potential future of the CCC. And in addition to leading the CCC, you've spent time on numerous committees at the NCAA level, including as the national chair of the NCAA Division III Baseball Committee and the D3 Interpretations and Legislation Committee and the Sportsmanship and Ethical Conduct Committee. What drives you to participate in all of these committees at the national level?
Absolutely. And to add to your list, back in the fall, I was added to the D3 football committee, which it's been kind of bittersweet, you know, because of the times that we're in. So, you know, there hasn't been a whole lot going on with that assignment. But really, I've always found that committee work allows me to give back and help move the division forward. Many people don't realize that the NCAA is the membership. You know, certainly there's building in Indianapolis, there's a staff that works in Indianapolis, but the lifeblood of the NCAA is the membership. We make the rules, we enforce the rules, we make sure that the experience when it comes to national championship participation is top-notch. And there's literally, you know, dozens of committees across each one of the three divisions, as well as the association in general. And that really brings a lot of wonderful leadership opportunities. Those committees really drive the NCAA, and the staff brings those committee outcomes to life. And for me, I've always felt that committee service, it allows me to learn, but also to use my talents for the greater good. It helps give the conference, or in the case of an individual institution who has somebody sitting on a committee, it provides some visibility and it gives a voice in the governance structure, while also setting the example for other younger coaches and administrators to also pursue involvement. You know, I've tried to have a balance of working on sport committees, which I really enjoy, but also a lot of other administrative committees where you may not necessarily have the interest that's out there. It's certainly glamorous to go and, you know, spend a week at a national championship tournament in a particular sport running that event, but sitting in a room for 3 days just talking about legislation and interpretation, you know, that may not be as attractive to some. So I really have always tried to balance that a little bit. And really with any sort of committee service, whether it's with the NCAA or even a committee within our conference, so to speak, you get to meet and become lifelong friends with people from all over the country who have similar interests that you maybe have never gotten the opportunity to cross paths with. But if you can be at a championship event with somebody else who also enjoys a particular sport, and you're doing nothing but living and breathing that championship throughout the year and, you know, on site at the event itself, that's really a special experience that a lot of people don't get. So I love being able to give back. I love being able to participate in the process and also hopefully set the example and encourage others to pursue those same types of opportunities.
Thank you so much for tuning into this week's episode of Hawk Talk. To catch the second half of our conversation with Commonwealth Coast Conference Commissioner Gregg Kaye, be sure to tune in next Thursday.